Okay, so how did J Dilla do his beats? How did he make those beats, and how did he make them sound so good? In this video, I'm just going to talk about what I think he did and how it can help you with your beats. Now, when you talk about J Dilla, right, most people are mainly talking about his drums. Okay, when you listen to his beats, you can tell that there's something definitely different about his beats compared to everyone else's at the time, right? And the first thing that people will say is, oh, he just didn't use any swing. Now, that's true, but it's also not true. I do believe that he did use some sort of swing or timing correction where it was needed. That's the feel that I get from this, because first of all, you gotta look back to how he made those beats, like what he was using. Okay, what he was using was the MPC 3000, which of course is an old school machine and it's got a great sequencer. He was just sampling from vinyl and making beats with that, and he came up with this iconic sound that to this day beat makers and producers are trying to emulate. Okay, now we'll never really know for sure exactly what he did, how he did those drums and all that. But from what I gather, from what I've heard and through his beats and also things I've read online, is that my conclusion is that he probably used some sort of, not necessarily swing, but definitely timing correction where it was needed. All right. Now, I have an example here with this drum track that I just put together real quick, a one bar track. And let's just listen to it. Okay, this is how I played it. With no timing correction. Okay, let's check it out. Now, as you can see right here, okay, we got the kick and then the snare and the hat. Now over here with the hat here, as it's highlighted, you can see that it's off the grid. Okay, I've got it slightly off the grid, of course. Actually, some of them are pretty much way off the grid, but like this one specifically, this one should be lined up, you know, right here or whatever. But you can tell that it's right off the grid. Okay, now it's just that with J Dilla, I believe that he would make his drums like this and then he would correct it wherever he felt that it was needed. So most likely he left it as is and just in certain spots he would correct it. So let's check out this other one right here, okay, where it's the same track. It's just that I'm going to go and correct it, okay? So right here, select it, and then quantize. Now check that out. Okay, now you can see everything's lined up exactly as it should be on the grid. Let's check it out. Now that sounds good, right? But it's just that, you know, of course, it's a typical beat you would hear today, the timing and all that. Now normally you have something like this, then you apply some swing to it so it gives it more of a human feel to it. So of course what J Dilla was trying to do was this here, where he would just have he wouldn't need the swing, he just had the timing like this. Okay, it was already given that human feel. All right, because that's the whole point, right? When you're trying to make some drums, is that you're trying to make it sound like it's from an actual drummer. Right, I mean, we're not trying to make EDM here, right? It's trying to make some hip-hop beats, and you want to make something that's going to sound fluid and more natural and all that, not so robotic, not so electronic. So basically that was what he was trying to do. All right, and I think that, you know, actually before I continue, you can see right here, okay, this is the one where the timing is off, and this is the one that's corrected. So you can see the difference right there, off, corrected. And you could definitely see how much more rigid this one is as it's corrected. But for this one, you can see it just looks more fluid right here. Okay. Now going over here, okay, we have the same loop. Okay, but this time I'll show you some of the correction here. Okay, because right here in Studio One, you got the quantize. It's on 16th. But what if I put it on 32nd triplets? Okay, now watch. So you can see right away the grid, it tightened up. It's smaller, it's tighter. Now, as I quantize it, see what happened right there? So you can see right here, for example, it's lined up on the grid, but you see this one right here, this hi-hat right here, where the timing seems to be lagging right there. So let's check it out. So that's pretty good right there. I like that. And I think that what he probably did, as I said, was that he probably went and just kind of moved stuff around. Oops. Move stuff around as needed. Something like this. Maybe bring this over here. Bring this one over here. Maybe put it like this and then move the snare over here, let's say. Okay, so let's check it like this as I moved it around randomly. Okay, see how it sounds. Now, to me, you could definitely hear right around here, around this part. I think around here specifically. To me, it sounds something like, you know, you would hear on a J Dilla track, right? Let's check it out again from here, right? So you definitely hear this lag, like it sounds like it's off. And you have to remember, like it's not that it's off really, it's just that it's the timing is there, it's just that, you know, things have been moved around. I mean, you got to look at it as for example with Old Dirty Bastard from Wu-Tang, right? I mean, he was one of those guys where, probably the only guy really at the time, where he was on beat but he wasn't. Okay, when you listen to his tracks, I mean, he was, that's what set this guy apart, was that his vocals, I mean, he wasn't just robotic with it, just trying to hit, you know, that 4-4 or whatever. He was off. It seemed like he was totally off the grid, so to speak, but he was always on time, you know? So it's like he wasn't just rapping straight through. He would always come back around as needed, but it's just that he would take a different path to get there, type of thing. So same thing with the drums. And like I said, I think that with Dilla, that's the thing that I get from all this, okay? That's my impression, is that he just spent a lot of time working on his drums, you know? And we all get caught up in doing the same old, right? We have these the software today and with controllers, and it just makes it really easy to make beats. It's really easy to just bang out some beats real fast. And I just think that that's kind of a bad thing, you know? Because like I was saying, he was using the MPC 3000. So any of those old school machines, of course, if you've used any of those, you'll know that it was a much slower process to get to where you're going. Whereas the software today, it makes it so much easier to just go and just make something really, really fast. So I could just pencil these notes in and just make a drum loop just like that, very simply. You know, it's just that it doesn't mean that's a good thing. So maybe I should be taking more time. Maybe we should all be taking more time to make our drums and really work on them to make it sound unique, you know? Because you look over here, this snare that's just off slightly, okay? You can bring it here, there, whatever. But let's say right here, just little things like that. And then, of course, the velocity, that makes a big difference, all right? So you're talking about somebody using quantizing in different formats, and then, you know, possibly some sort of swing as well. But then also the movement of the drums, right? Where you're moving the notes, where you're placing them. Some of them are lagging, like right here. Some of them are lagging off the grid. Some of them are a little forward on the grid. So I think that's what he did, all right? Same thing here with this kick. You can see the kick is not on the grid. It's slightly off. And especially when you're making drums, is that, you know, the easiest thing you could do is the hi-hats, right? Is that you change the where the hi-hats hit. Okay, and I think what he mainly did was have the hi-hats just lagging slightly. Maybe some of the snares were just forward slightly. Same thing with the kicks, just forward, just slightly. So when you do that, of course, you're going to create this certain groove for the drums. And then, of course, as you add your samples to it, or if you're using virtual instruments, then you're going to follow those drums, right? So your whole mix is going to sound unique because you're not just this robotic, you know, EDM, follow the grid type of beat, right? So to me, that's what he did with his beats. I think that he was just spending a lot of time working on his drums, perfecting them, and just giving it that special groove. And that's why everybody tries to this day, they try to still make something that sounds like Dilla. And, you know, you could try all you want, but still, we'll never really know what his secret formula was. But I think that this is what he probably did. And if anything, though, it's a good learning tool for all of us, is that, you know, we need to spend more time working on our drums and really perfecting it instead of just banging out something real quick. Just work on something like this. Take your time. And, you know, I'm guilty of it, too, right? I just bang out some drums real fast and then I move on. But still, there's times where I really do want to sit down and just, you know, really move stuff around and make it sound different than, you know, whatever else is out there. So I think that's what set Dilla apart from everyone else, is that he just spent a lot more time working on everything. As you can see with a grid like this, I mean, you know, the timing, it doesn't look right, but still, it's not about that necessarily. It's about the sound of it. And he definitely had a unique sound. So, once again, with this one, with the timing just... See, right here, you can tell with this snare and hat, I moved it over because the snare, to me, moving it forward, okay, but then with the hat over here, didn't sound right. So let's move it on grid, and then it gives it a nice sound, right? With the hat coming in just before the snare, gives it more of a human feel. The other thing that Dilla was known for was also the velocity, okay? Because you can see right here with my hats here, you can see, of course, you could just adjust... Oops, you could adjust the velocity of each note as needed, right? Because what he also did with his drums was he would have certain parts of it. So for example, the snare, he'd have certain snares that would be maybe a little louder than others, maybe even quieter. And I'm not just talking about like ghost notes or something, but also like just, you know, snares in general, just not just in the loop, but throughout the whole track. Because I think what he probably did was have... he'd have his loops, and then once he'd build it up as a whole track of drums, then he would go through the whole track and alter each note as needed, you know. So I could be wrong, but I'm assuming that's what he did, because that's what it sounds like when I listen to his beats. And also, as I mentioned, you know, from reading stuff online, from what people said, from what they feel, they also, you know, feel the same way, is that he probably just adjusted things wherever he felt it was needed. So in other words, he was going by the feel of the beat and the type of feel that he was looking for. So instead of just banging out something real quick and then mixing it and putting it out there, this guy was taking a lot of time, as we all should. So so if anything, this should be a learning tool for all of us. Definitely work on your drums and work on the timing. Don't worry about the swing right away. Definitely work on the timing and play with the different quantizing, because look at all the different quantize options we have here just in Studio One. So just play with them and see what you can come up with, and then, you know, you might discover something completely different than you've ever done before. So it's a great way to learn as well. So with that being said, go make some beats.